Oi, oi, alright, alright, how's it going? I'm Grant, you're you. This is Duda Review. Today marks the first in a new series. It's called Our Band in Three Albums. In this video and this series, we chat to bands and they tell us the three records that were influential to them and three albums that I guess that could serve as the blueprint to their sound overall. We're kicking it off talking to Charlie from the mighty noise rock post-hardcore band Predeceased. They put out an awesome record, What Do You Do, last year, and have just released a new double single, The News, which is out now, and Sun Reader, which is coming out May 10th. Links to the tracks and the albums down below. Check these guys out if you're fans of Fugazi, Unwound, Unsane, Metz, Jesus Lizard, and Quicksand. Yeah, all right, without further ado, let's get into it. The first, the way I like to start any of these things, man, is like if whether or not you look at your phone or you just remember, but like before you logged onto this call, like what was the last piece of music you listened to?
Archers of Loaf.
Archers of Loaf.
Yeah, do you know them?
No, I don't know them.
Yeah, like a 90s indie rock band, sort of in line with like Guided by Voices and like Superchunk and stuff like that. I think their album was on Merge Records. They did an album back in the 90s called Icky Metal, which is like regarded as one of the best indie rock albums of the 90s, really.
I'm making a note of that.
Yeah.
It sounds right.
I'm sure a lot of people will call it a surface scratcher thing, but I've long given up trying to impress people with the deep cut knowledge of stuff these days.
Mate, I mean, you say that, but we were chatting before, obviously, getting this set up, and a couple of the bands that you mentioned, I was like, turn me on to some cool shit I'd not heard of, like Heavy, Heavy Lolo. Not heard of them before we were chatting. So, yeah, I think it's a little bit certainly deeper than my level of service anyway.
It's not a competition. I used to view it as a contest or whatever, but that was, I found that was actually quite a quick way to alienate people in the pub.
That is true. That is like how to win friends and alienate people.
Yeah, especially where, but most of the time it's a lot more fun just chatting about Nirvana.
True. That is true. Something everyone can agree on, hopefully. Yeah. All right. So the whole point of this, the whole reason we chatted was the kind of point of the show is our band in three albums. Concept being that if someone asked you about Predeceased in general, whether it be you wanted to describe the album or the band or the concept behind the band, instead of words, we talk about it in three albums. Mm-hmm. First one you sort of put forward was Converge, You Fail Me. So just for the benefit of people listening, watching, You Fail Me is metalcore Converge's fifth album, first one on Epitaph, released in 2004. The biggest question, the most important question is it Converge or is it Converge?
I was saying Converge for years, and then I was watching a live video recently and then Jake the singer said Converge. I don't know.
I have the same thing. The thing in my head is always like the actual, if you were to read that word in a book or in a sentence, normally you'd say Converge, but I don't know why, as I see it as a standalone, like name for a band, my inclination is to say Converge. I don't know why.
Yeah. And I think when I first read into them, like it's like Converge is like a traffic term. It's like for converging into traffic or something like that. It's like a really, okay. It's like a really mundane terminology, which I've found really funny because they make wildly intense music.
Exactly. So why is this such an important album to you and what's its bearing on Sound of Predeceased?
I guess it was because, you know, Jane Doe's the big one by them. And I do, I'm going to qualify this statement by saying I didn't want to go for the classic one.
That was going to be my next question. You've already preempted it. I was like, Jane Doe's the one everyone talks about.
Which is an incredible album. Like, you can't, like, I don't think you can fault it. Like, it holds up, like, it's intense from end to end. And, you know, but, and then the slower songs on it and all that kind of thing. It made them, they just leveled up at that point. Yeah, I think with the reason why I like You Fail Me more is they really stretched out on the sound that they'd already established on Jane Doe, and I think like the guitaring of it is like weirder. It's like it's less just straight thrash riffs and stuff like their early material. It was very I read an interview or watched an interview with Kurt when he was it was like a Guitar World interview or something, like a rig rundown, one of them videos, and he
Love
was
those going on a YouTube wormhole downloads.
and it this wasn't pertaining to You Fail Me, but it was he basically broke down the band as he was like his simplest terms he could describe his band is like the it's just if you just smush Slayer and Sonic Youth together.
Oh yeah. That
And
kind of makes sense.
it was like You Fail Me, it was like from a guitarist standpoint, that's when I feel like Kurt started getting really weird and interesting with it. And it was like, because Jane Doe, a load of it was written when they still had Aaron Dalbeck from Bane on second guitar still. So they could all like and I've got a thing about like bands with just one guitar anyway. Like I think it's weirder. I think it's like you can be weirder with it and like cooler and more original. And I think You Fail Me is like a really good example of him really stretching out like what he can do as the only guitar player in a band. Like there's that tune, the standout one on that, which explains what I'm saying far better than me, is the song Dropout. If you listen to that, it's got all the chugginess at one point, and then it's got like weird tappy bits and loop pedal stuff and everything.
I remember because like when I kind of do these ones, if I don't already kind of have them in my library or whatever, or I haven't listened to them in a while, I'll go through and my notes for Dropout are just like, this is mental, this is like all of these different bits, and it's kind of got, like you say, it's got almost every aspect of that guitar playing in kind of one song, and there's some just insane unhinged sounds going
Song's
on in that
short as
track.
well. I think it's like less than 3 minutes long as well, and it's just like said about five different things. So five wildly unique different things on guitar in like a really short space of time without ever sounding like scatty and randomized or whatever. It's all very well thought out and everything as well. So yeah, I think really that's a big one for me as a guitar player.
Yeah, definitely. And so was this the album? I'm guessing not. It wasn't your the album that got you into Converge. It will.
No, it's Jane Doe.
Yeah,
Like,
right. Okay.
yeah.
But this one is the one. And is it what would you so would you say this might be a dumb question, but is it your like personal favorite in terms of their like whole catalog?
It's my favorite Converge record.
Nice.
Well, like
I
there's a little clique of Converge fans that like You Fail Me more than Jane Doe.
I do always see that online. That's like the kind of like little argument, and there's always, I suppose that it's like that. I find it funny in a lot of bands that are like that. There's the album that the kind of, I hesitate to say mainstream, but depending on what genre you're in, the broad accepted, understood classic album, and then underneath that, there's always a contingent of fans being like, well, actually, but if it's all good, it's all good.
I mean, I probably sound like that anyway, but whatever. They're a good band. They have great records.
It's a fucking
That's
awesome
my
album.
favorite of their great records. It's as simple as that, really.
Yeah, I mean, I have to get into Converge more than I already am. Like, oh, they're a band for me that I have random albums of theirs that I know well, and like for some reason, aside from You Fail Me, which I listened to quite a lot ahead of talking to you, it's their most recent one, and then what's the one? I don't think it's Axe to Fall. It's got the black and white cover. It might have been after Axe to Fall. Aimless Arrow, or is Aimless Arrow on
It's
it?
got Aimless Arrow on it. It might be All We Love We Leave Behind.
That's the one, I think.
Maybe. Or something Dusk. I don't know. I can't remember.
So Dusk is the latest one, Dusk Within Us.
Right.
and then that, and then now this. Those are the three that I know. And but I've not found fault really with any of them. They're all fucking sick in their own ways. And they've got a new album coming out this year, I think.
Oh, are they?
Yeah, I think June, possibly.
Okay.
So, number one, album number one, Predeceased in three albums, You Fail Me. The second was Shellac at Action Park. Again, for those listening not familiar, this is the debut album from Shellac, released in 1994. The band's led by the famed producer Steve Albini, who's obviously worked on hundreds and hundreds of albums, but he is forever associated with Nirvana and In Utero. They've got five albums, and actually, again, they've got a sixth album, their first in 10 years, is due out next month, which is pretty exciting. How did you first hear about Shellac and this album specifically?
This would have been illegal download age, LimeWire times or whatever. There was a
It
site called Epitonic,
okay. Not
and
familiar with that one.
they had a, it was like a 6 minute like history of math rock thing where a guy spoke about the short history of math rock and then mentioned bands like Don Caballero and Bastro and everything, and Shellac were on it. And then I think it was an audio file and you played it at the top, and then they very, very briefly spoke about the bands he was talking about on it, and then it was like, check that album out or whatever. But I don't think it was Action Park I heard first. I mean, the first song I probably heard by them was the Watch song, which is on
Right.
Fat Hurts. At Action Park, that's, I'd say the reason I picked it for this conversation that we're having is, I think that was it was the it's the best way for, like, that was like the blueprint of like what me and George wanted to do with the band,
Right.
to the point where, well, it was more the, actually, I'll correct myself, it was more to the point what George wanted to do with the band. I really wanted a second guitar player for a long time because I just spent 9 years playing in a band with a second guitar player, so I straight up thought I just didn't have it in me to like do stuff by myself anymore. But it was George was being like, no, let's be a trio. It was like, all my favorite bands are trios, blah blah blah. Like, his two favorite bands are Nirvana and Rush. So
Well,
he's like, let's do a trio. It's like, trust me, you've got it. We did a trio when we were in college. It's like, you can do this. So I think just for the very practical reason of just like, they're just a really great example of a three-piece band, and that first record is a great example of them being a solid three-piece band. There's kind of not a great deal more to elaborate on that one, to be honest. It's just it was a good blueprint for us to work towards when we started out.
I mean, it's a pretty good blueprint to have if what you're wanting is a trio band.
But don't get me wrong, there's fucking tons of bands that are like, we sound like Shellac, blah, 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 blah. But I feel like they're a bit more incelly than us.
One way to put it. I was thinking that, like, one of the things, and I don't know how, and again, Shellac, I knew their last, the Dude Incredible is the one I'm familiar with. This was like their first one that I went back to, but like as I was going through and like researching, I think one of the things that I always love that bands do, and these guys do a lot, is like how they it kind of expand the lore through different things that they do. And so, like, I think on their record sleeve, they've got like an illustration of like a whole medical text, like resuscitation from an apparent death by electric shock, and all of those things. Like, do you guys think of anything from that point of view, like from an aesthetic point of view, when you're putting together like the artwork, or the sleeves, or anything? Like, do you pull inspiration from bands like Shellac or others when beyond the sound?
I'll admit, I'm not, I front like I'm not very aesthetically minded, but I do a little label, Easy Records, which I put this out on or whatever, and I can't draw or anything, but I know like what I like, and I know what designers are like and all that kind of thing. And Like a mate of mine did the logo. It was like, I like a lot of old, like kind of trashy 70s comic books, like Robert Crumb stuff and Freak Brothers and everything. So like, so that's a roundabout way of me saying like, I keep thinking of, to me, which I think are dumb, silly little ideas for like artwork or whatever. Like the What Do You Do artwork. I've gone through about three artists and just the briefs I was given, don't worry, I still paid them, by the way. But I was like, what I was briefing them, and I'll admit, I didn't really know what I was doing at the time, so I was changing the idea a lot. Anyway, we went through this a few times with a few different people, like, and it just ended one day. I was just like, fuck it, I'm just gonna lay out a table with a load of items. Because I was working away a lot, I was having loads of like just different. Just shit on me at all times. And like, there's like loads of train tickets on there because I was traveling loads for work and all that kind of thing. Sunglasses were the sunglasses I was wearing that summer. And I haven't got a copy of the album with me. No. Anyway, I'm not going to talk through the art with you.
I'll shove it up on the screen when we're talking.
But at the time, like every little knick-knack or trinket or whatever, like was representing something I was going through during the pandemic, basically.
It does remind me a lot of the everyday detritus that you pick up along the way, right? Like you got like the half pack of ibuprofen or whatever in there,
I think that
the
was vitamin D.
for the night
Yeah,
after.
because I was a bit, yeah. I like operating things like on a budget. Like I like spend, you know, I like spending money where it needs to be spent. Like I'll make sure the album's recorded well and I'll make sure the album's mastered well. But it's like, even when we make videos and stuff like that, like I like the restrictions of not having much money. Well, I have no choice but to like the restrictions of being skint. But yeah, that album cover was done. My friend Carolina came round and shot it, and she brought a few knickknacks to it as well. And like after spending about 500 or 600 pound, like paying artists like first drafts or whatever, it's like we did this shoot in my lounge on a coffee table my mum gave me, and yeah, and I think I bought Carolina like a four pack of San Miguel for doing it or something, and it was like I like the idea of getting away with things cheap, like. How I'm trying to put it, I'm very good. I'm good with not a lot of money.
I see what you mean. And also it comes back to what we were saying before about like when you have an unlimited or like a lot of time or resource or whatever, then you don't have to be as careful about the decisions you make. And I think it ultimately, like removing things and giving yourself limitations is normally a good way to get something quality out of it, because otherwise you just procrastinate.
Yeah, and I mean, I don't know, the very premise of a vinyl was pretty restrictive anyway. Like you had to have art at a certain size, you can only have so many minutes on each side and all that kind of thing. You have to sequence it to make sure it doesn't run over each side and everything. And that's something, you know, because I put it out myself, that's something I'm working on it every step as well. So it's something I like to be quite hands-on with, and I can only assume, probably quite accurately, that Shellac are exactly the same way with their stuff.
No,
But
definitely. I've been from everything that I've seen.
yeah, I mean, bands like that, and like Minutemen, and like Husker Du, and like a lot of like, you know, go back as far as Black Flag and stuff like that. That's all cut from that same creative cloth, I think. Yeah, I know Shellac, like we're releasing everything on Touch and Go, but that's still by generally like a one person setup, and it's, yeah, I've just always liked the way all those bands did stuff because they knew how to make it look good despite,
I
you
was
know.
going to say actually your new the single artwork gives me a lot of like Raymond Pettibon,
Oh,
Blackfly,
yeah.
like
Yeah, it's
that
got that
stuff.
vibe to it a little bit. That's, yeah, I mean, you can't fault the Black Flag look. I mean, that's my favorite logo of all time, I think. And it's so simple.
Yeah.
Yeah,
Iconic.
that's done by Tin Savage, who he does loads of stuff, loads and loads of bands. Like he's done like Flex Records and everyone. Don't type that in, do a little thing
Yeah.
or do a
I'll
little
put it
bit
up
or
or
whatever.
scroll.
Yeah,
It looks amazing. I'll
yeah.
have to see what other stuff he's done that I recognize.
Yeah. Yeah, you probably
So
recognize it.
three albums then. So we've had Converge, You Fail Me, just had Shellac, Action Park. The third one was Modest Mouse, The Lonesome Crowded West.
Yes.
The Washington Band's second album released in 1997. This is an album I was completely unfamiliar with, and but both previous bands I had known different albums from, and I know what they're like. Modest Mouse are always a band that I've heard of and like registered in my brain as like I need to go to them at some point.
Yeah.
But I don't know if you have this where I kind of like assume a certain sound based on little snippets of what I've read and people have said or whatever. And for some reason, the bracket that I had these guys pinned in were not the same as what I actually heard. Like for me, I was thinking of Death Cab and Wilco and
Yeah.
those sorts of bands, which I see a few of them are like linked as related artists or whatever in the Wikipedia. But when I put it on, it was not that at all. It feels much more at home with the three albums that we've just
Yeah.
discussed, particularly at Action Park.
Yeah.
So yeah, I mean, it sounds. Yeah, sounds great. Like what led you to this one? Are you familiar with their whole like body of work? Is this a favorite out of all of it, or like what's the
It's certainly my favorite. Yeah, I
yeah.
mean this album is legit like a top five record for me as well. Like, you know, take that one on the desert island or whatever. Yeah, it's just growing up really liking indie rock and stuff. I mean, I grew up like loving stuff like Beck and like Beastie Boys and stuff. I know Beasties aren't indie, but you know, it's I cut them from that same cloth as well, like, you know,
Yeah.
weird 90s music, creative 90s music as well. And yeah, I think the big thing about that for me, and it's a big favorite album for George as well, is yeah, it's got jams on it. It's very jammy,
Yeah.
but not in that horrible blues lawyer way or meandering Grateful Dead way. Like, don't get me wrong, I like Grateful Dead, but like that does not apply to us.
I know what
But
you mean. Yeah.
what I like about Modest Mouse is it's, you know, the playing's there and everything, but they're not like virtuoso players and stuff, but they can still sit in the cut of something and like ride it out really well and keep it interesting. And again, Isaac's I'm saying that like I know him personally, but Isaac Brock on guitar is another big influence on me as a guitar player. Like another great example of someone who's quite very, very weird, and certainly when they started had to find a way to stand out because he was the only guitar player.
Yeah, it's got the very like angular, abrasive kind of everything at a right angle type sort of
Yeah.
sound to it,
Yeah.
which I
And
really like.
yeah, I think that tune Trucker's Atlas on it, which is probably the longest one on the record, that's like a great example of there's no predeceased music that's particularly jamming. It's all very set and all that kind of thing. But I think this album in particular is the one that it made us okay with not just having to be like riff, riff, riff.
Yeah.
Then just kind of be like, oh no, let's kind of like if we're enjoying a certain part or whatever, like a tune like Can't Is the Real C Word on the first record, like that it's that kind of thing that makes us feel okay with doing like an extended bridge or something like that because it can work.
Yeah, totally.
I
That's
think.
really, it's really interesting that you say that though, because I still think What Do You Do, that whole album, is pretty succinct. But it'll be interesting to hear if in your like future stuff that you know, maybe that comes from a point of view of wanting to, like you said, originally being a little bit fearful of kind of getting too out there with it, but whether that might expand in time, if this is like some of the reference that you're kind of drawing from and stuff like that.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, the bands I've the three bands that we're talking about with this, they're all bands that, were doing a lot of their big gigging in the 90s, and it was when they did go away for a month or 2 months at a time, and they could, they did have endless gigs to like really stretch out things or whatever. And I'd certainly like to be able to get to that point with us, but we're a way off from that yet. But yeah, I think that's just how bands used to operate back then.
Yeah, definitely. I
Great
mean,
to hear.
there's so much fertile ground for that though, with the material that you've got. But
Yeah.
if it's going more aggressive, which you said up top about the new stuff, does that mean it's getting the song lengths are getting shorter or?
Yeah, at times. I don't know, like the second album, which I don't know when we're gonna release that. It's not gonna be this year, it'll be next year. That ends with like a 6 minute thing that just keeps rolling and rolling over on the same riff pretty much.
Sick.
Yeah, which yeah, that's definitely like a jammer.
Nice. And th those songs from the second album, are these like, are you given any of them, play when you're out there live, even if the record's not coming out?
Oh yeah, we've already been playing them live.
Cool.
Yeah, we just I wanted to, well, we said when we started gigging, we wanted to learn, we wanted to always know 30 songs and just pick 10 whenever we played or whatever. So like we didn't just want to phone it in and play the same set every time. I feel like that would make us become quite lax, like quite lazy when we play
Yeah.
or whatever.
It's fun to mix it up anyway, isn't it? And then, you don't fall into any routine or you don't fall into autopilot if you're like playing like a bunch of nights on a row. Keeps it
Yeah,
fresh.
and I mean, I work as a guitar tech at times as well, and I go away with bands, and yeah, they play the same set every night, and it elicits different reactions from people every time. Of course, it does, because you're in a different room, different country, different people and stuff. But yeah, and of course, I understand the practicality of bigger bands playing the same things every night and having to have lighting cues
When you've
and.
got cues and graphics and all that stuff,
Of
yeah.
course, all of that makes sense, but yeah, it's not a way I'd like to operate at any point.
Yeah, definitely. All right. Well, those then are like the three albums: Converge, You Fail Me, Shellac, Action Park, Modest Mouse, Lonesome Crowded West. Definitely check them out if you haven't heard them, if you are new to them like I was. And with when it comes to Predeceased, I'm going to keep everything linked in the description below. I think you guys are out on tour in the next month or so.
Yeah, next May we're doing a bunch of weekends.
Sweet. I'm
And
hoping to try and get out to a London
yeah,
show.
please do.
Yeah, it'd be sick. Hey, there we are. Thanks very much to Charlie for giving up the time to chat and for recommending these albums, which were all pretty new to me. Check out Predeceased at the links below. Look out for them on tour, especially if you're in the UK, and look out for more in this series coming very soon. Cheers, mate. Bye.